Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our presentation, and we are happy to talk to you today about absent leadership. It's an interesting topic that does not come to our mind automatically when we think about the reasons of poor well-being in the workplace. But we're here today with our experts from Cesar's colleges and Hotelschool The Hague to tell you more about it. So we will tell to you today about the way how we can lead for well-being and how to prevent absent leadership for improving talent management and reducing stress in organizations. Although there are many steps that individuals can take to feel better in an organization and to maintain the emotional and mental well-being on their own, sometimes we need to take a different route. Sometimes it is the organizational leadership that should be questioned first. Several issues can undermine the ability of an organization to maintain emotional and mental well-being in the workplace. This could be inefficient leadership. For example, that could be corruption as authority abuse. It could be nepotism, as preferring to appoint your close relatives and likely-minded individuals into key positions. It could be cronyism, which is appointing underqualified individuals who will convey the messages of other leaders behind the scenes. Finally, inefficient leadership could take form of the absent leadership, and this is what we're going to talk about today. It's one of the dysfunctional leadership forms, and our expert panel will discuss how exactly absent leadership undermines both employees' and leaders' well-being. And we will talk about the way how to address this issue. Now I would like to pass the word to Dr. Cavelzani, who will tell you more about what absent leadership is.
Thank you very much to you for organizing this interesting roundtable, and also to the people who can join. Alors, I will start immediately with the definition, what we can understand talking about absent leader. The definition refers in a psychological perspective the idea that when the leader fails to provide guidance from one side or emotional support to own a team, we can have negative and severe outcomes in terms of lack of engagement, lack of care, and then ultimately lack of productivity, lack of performance. Consequently, the risk for deluding a customer, so disappointing customer in their coming, in their enjoying our product or service, is becoming very, very risky. And let me clarify the same concept conversely. Performance, productivity, requires human engagement, particularly in the hospitality, where the product is not only composed by food and beverage and nice decoration of the hotel or the restaurant or the airline or the spa resort. This is for sure one ingredient, but the second major ingredient for our conversation is the service, so the human service. So product performance, productivity, need to be related to the quality of the service. That's why the quality of the service can go down and enter in a mediocrity level that we call lack of engagement, lack of care for the customer, as well as lack of collaboration in the teams, can be caused by lack of guidance from the leadership. For example, although the goals can be clear, For example, we need to run the hotel, we need to run the restaurant, we need to achieve money, profit. It may be not very clear who is in charge to do what. So lack of clarification regarding either the task or lack of clarification regarding the roles may be one example of failing to be directive. So to clarify roles, assignment, checking for results, supporting. The second ingredient is instead emotional engagement, care. Emotional engagement can be realized or need to be realized by situational leadership approach. Situational leadership means, according to some jobs, people, the employees, knows already what to do and how to do the job. But they may be risky to disengage for other purposes. For example, the job is routinary, is repetitive, is not challenging. For example, housekeeping or some kitchen activities that may be routinary, repetitive, not challenging according to their personality, may be fragile, may be at risky for lack of engagement, lack of care. So, that's are the situations where the leader, instead of be directive, must change the leadership style and be more supportive or coaching. Coaching is the combination between guidance and emotional care. Otherwise, what is the risk? Is that the risk is that the people may disconnect, showing indeed lack of care, or can even start, as Evelina was mentioned in the introduction, employees may even show dysfunctional behaviors in the direction to be sabotaging behavior, like, for example, aggressivity, complaining. In psychoanalysis, we call example of passive-aggressive behaviors in the employees. When the people are grouping because one person is starting complaining or showing hostile behaviors, that actually is a request to be cared. There is a request that someone, the leader, must vigilate, must create a dialogue. But when the leader is failing, we have this request who turn into negative behaviors. So becomes a dysfunctional way to express the employee's needs for care. So one employee, two employees, a group of employees can start in grouping together and show a negative attitude against the company. So passivity is one very common profile of group behaviors. People are doing the job with no much care and not participating in problem-solving activities, not creating creative solutions, not innovating, but just, you know, projecting aggressively the idea that you are the leader, you must solve all the problems, but in a hostile way. Alternatively, passive-aggressive modality is when the people are actively wasting time in the working place, you know, sabotaging, lurking for alternatives, and showing hostility against the company. These are examples of passive-aggressive modality. Another very common profile of group unconscious behavior that are the consequences of absent leadership is a resignation. Resignation modality is when the people go to the workplace because they must. This is my salary, I must go, but I don't bring my enthusiasm, my passion. It's just one work. And you know, the customer notice very well. Because again, luxury hospitality particularly is not only composed by a good champagne, but the complexity of the factor involving quality of the service. So absent leadership is when the leader has no appropriate theoretical knowledge. That's why we are teaching the class to provide situational leadership skills. Theoretical knowledge is also important to address the four motivational drives that Professor Noria from Harvard Business School also mentioned. The four motivational drives, such as acquire, money, career, benefit, but also bond. Bond when with the leader succeeded to create a brand, no? When the people are proud to go to the workplace. It's not just a office, it's my family, it's my company. This is bond. Then there is C. C is comprehend, when the leader succeed to create, to explain why your job is so important. Not only what to do, but why your job is so precious in the service. Last motivational drive is also the defend, as all over the world, all the people need to perceive to be treated fairly, to be treated against discrimination, against isolation. They can see the future in the company. So when the leader, in conclusion, is failing to apply appropriate theoretical knowledge, such as situational leadership and the four motivational drives, the consequences of lack of engagement and mediocrity may be observed in the team as well as in the customer dissatisfaction. Another cause and factor why the leader may be absent is, of course, the dysfunctional personality of the leader. Sometimes the leader is not aware about how the leader is behaving and responding to stimuli. Sometimes also the employees may be challenging. They may have personality issues. We can be stressed for the coronavirus, for a loss in the family, for many other personal reasons that may negatively affect our quality. And so when the leader fails to create a dialogue, an understanding, or give a value to the resource, the resource feel more isolated. Sometimes employees have particularly demanding personalities that requires not only theoretical knowledge, but also emotional intelligence and the capacity to create a particular care. So that's something that the leader can create, otherwise turn into be absent. Absent is not only then when someone is physically away, but most of the absent leadership is when the people are there, but the mind is not completely situational oriented and full of understanding for such dynamics. So that's in few words the concept of absent leadership, requiring a lot of knowledge and a lot of emotional intelligence to practice situational leadership, the four drives, and recognizing the different profile of group unconscious behaviors that may result in obstacling, blocking, and pulling away the morality and the performance of the team. That's in few words, but we can perhaps exploring another angle of this story with my prestigious colleagues today.
Great, thank you very much, Alessandro. So these are very important points that you raised and it helps us already to highlight two main takeaways. So our takeaway number one is that the absent leadership is one of dysfunctional leadership forms that threatens emotional and mental well-being for employees, but for leaders themselves. Also, we have the possibility to highlight the second takeaway is that absent leadership leads to a lot of specific practical negative consequences for organization as a whole. through creation of negative unconscious group dynamics, high employee turnover, higher stress for both leaders and employees. And at the end of the day, it undermines the productivity at individual organization level. So when we talk about productivity, when we talk about performance, we're touching upon another very important domain that could be affected by the absent leadership, the human resource management. Now I will invite our colleague, Dr. David Brannon, to talk about talent management, one of HR, so human resource practices. I will ask David to tell us how human resource management and talent management in particular could be affected by absent leaders. Please, David.
I think it's important to recognize that in many industries, many organizations, one of the most crucial aspects that they're missing today is talent. You will often hear this in the news, the adage, the war for talent has become a very popular concept amongst businesses and organizations. And often you'll hear CEOs talking about, you know, this talent recruitment, this talent need. So what exactly is talent and how does it relate to absent leadership? Talent, the first, although they didn't necessarily specifically refer to it in this fashion, can be traced to Lipak and Snell, who really highlighted that this homogeneous perspective on employees, everybody being equal, didn't really match with how organizations were structuring themselves, but also the value that servants and employees present to the organization. And in that sense, though there's a lot of debate about whether talent management should be inclusive, exclusive, in a typical sense, talent management is what Lipak and Snell would refer to as the high value, difficult to replace employees, those who add strategic value to the organization and whose value the organization needs to account for and care for so that they don't lose it, worst case scenario, to a competitor who themselves would be able to take advantage of it. So what is talent management? Now, if we look at some of the early definitions of talent management, it's just simply, looking at HR through a different lens. Others will describe it as being exactly like Lipak and Snell, this high elite group of employees. Others will talk about it being a supply chain, basically filling up your vacancies. And I think it's especially in these contexts that we need to recognize that the work, for example, by Yost and McDowell and Burbeck really brings light to it, is that talent in a practical sense is often defined by three features: an individual's potential, an individual's performance, and an individual's mobility. So let's look at these through the lens of an absent leadership. First, potential. The potential an individual has is a reflection of the skills, the development, the opportunities that they get. With an absent leader, the challenge is that many of these resources, potentially access to training programs, development opportunities, even career guidance, worst case scenario, just motivation to remain with the company in the future becomes obviously dented. So absent leadership is very crucial for, you know, identifying that talent, but particularly from a perspective of looking for the future to see how they can grow and remain within the organization. The second thing, which I think is very important to recognize in terms of absent leadership, which we've already stressed upon, is that leadership in very common terms is often associated with performance. Now, performance is obviously stimulated, and we know this from classic motivation theory, by recognition, by esteem, by appreciation, very simple terms, which in practice, in the absence of a leader, are difficult to deliver. It is very difficult for somebody to keep motivated and keep engaged when indeed there is no leader around that recognizes that or appreciates that. So in order for individuals to maintain as well as sustain performances, it's important that leaders not only give them the impetus and the recognition and the motivation to achieve their high levels of performance, but also to recognize when potentially the individual might be striving too far that could lead to a burnout if they try to maintain a level of performance which was unsustainable. So a leader not only has to ensure that the performance that an individual gives at the present is to the best, but is also recognizing this in a longer term where, you know, is this something that they can do? And bear in mind that often these employees, these talents, they are in a period of growth. They're in a period of development. They do not necessarily have the experience to guide, judge, evaluate their own efforts in the wider picture. So this is exactly why it's important to have leaders there that can guide and direct and encourage, but also retain, when necessary, individuals as required. The other thing to consider is that mobility. Now, mobility can mean many things in an organization, but crucially, what it also means in an organization is the ability for an individual to move socially in the organization. So in order for that to occur, an individual needs the network and possibilities to connect with others, right? So whether that's hearing of an opportunity in a different subsidiary, whether that's hearing of a position in the organization, whether indeed it is the leader recognizing the individual as being ready for promotion and bringing this, whether it is to HR or people higher in the organization. And again, this can only occur in the event that the leader themselves are present and able to bond with the employee to achieve this feat. So as I say, if you look at the key aspects around and related to talent management, mobility, potential, performance, it's very key that the leader is there to guide, to encourage, to promote, to restrict when necessary, but also to give them the platforms that they need in order to go on and be successful as they develop their career. So take all of this away, and the reality is that your talent will not only stifle, will probably remain untapped and unfulfilled, but in worst case scenario, will leave your organization in favor for another organization where indeed they will get the leader who will support and encourage and give them those possibilities. So thank you very much. And I think those are some of the key aspects to really bear in mind when we talk about absent leadership in relationship to talent management.
Great. Thank you very much, David. From what we have learned about talent management is that it does undermine chances of individuals to succeed if it is done in a case of absent leadership. We could also say that the company would face potential succession issues in case if there is no sufficient talent that has been developed, or if the talent has not been able to unfold their full potential and showed poor performance under poor leadership guidance. So this gives us an opportunity to formulate an important takeaway. It's our takeaway number three from our today's expert talk, that the absent leadership creates dysfunctional talent management. And it does so by undermining individual and group performance. So now that we have learned about the impact, severe negative impact that absent leadership could have on talent management, we're going to think together about the way how we can address these challenges in practice. And our next expert, Dr. Jorge Arnanz, will talk to us about it.
Thank you very much, Evelina, and thank you, Alessandro and David, for this interesting introduction. So the first thing is that I'm going to cover mainly one of the sides of absent leadership, that is the part of the physical absence of the leaders. I believe that in most of the cases, business owners or even managers or leaders in general, they would be more present at the early stages of the operation of a business or at the early stages of when they take over the leadership role, etc., until they feel comfortable enough to maybe start being a bit less present as well. And then this is something that we need to start thinking of and we need to start addressing from the very beginning. There's gonna be a moment in which physically the leader is not gonna be in the business. So how we can manage it? Most of the companies, they will focus on delegation, of course, and there's a lot of theories, a lot of papers talking about delegation, the effective ways of delegating, etc. But I would say that in most of the cases, in reality, in practice, the big problem is that we tend to delegate only the operational side. We will focus on delegating tasks, delegating technical skills, etc. But we are missing one important thing that would be about transmitting or delegating some leadership skills or leadership behaviors as well. One of the examples that Alessandro mentioned during his introduction as well was we were talking about situational leadership that we covered also in another summit. So this is something very important. Many times we tell our followers how to cover our space when we are not going to be physically there in terms of tasks, skills, etc. But they don't know much about the leadership styles. They don't know much about how to adapt the leadership styles depending on the situation, on the people, etc. And this is something that should be addressed as well from the beginning. So this, if we don't do it, it will lead to some of the negative aspects that we saw already, like, for example, conflicts, demotivation of the employees, employee disengagement, and at the end of the day, it can lead to also a high level of turnover. So what I'm planning and what I'm aiming to give you from my own perspective and my own experience, based on my business experience as a restaurant owner and manager for 5 years in Thailand, I realized that in the past, when I was in some leadership position or some followership positions as well, I realized that there was a problem when the leader wasn't there physically. So I tried to create kind of a system or to follow some steps in order to prevent this and in order to make sure that when this physical absence need to be there, it's not going to be negatively affecting employees and the operation of the restaurant, of the business in general. So what I decided and what we implemented, it was to create at the beginning what we can call a pre-absence behavior, a pre-absence strategy. It would be creating a culture of shared leadership and shared responsibility. This is something that many times, especially when we are talking about businesses, that they are more operational and that they have very defined positions like restaurants, in which there would be it would be an owner or a manager, and then each of the other people, they would have operational responsibilities. It's important to first educate the employees, educate the followers, and explain to them and show them the clear direction that we are following. So, for example, if in our case, we are focused on situational leadership, trying to adapt the leadership to the different situations, different personalities, etc. This should be something that is shown not just to the leaders, but to every employee as well. This is something that, again, this is related to the culture of the organization and should be there from the very beginning. When we set and we define the positions of the different employees, it's important to also share what is our strategy in terms of leadership. Then it's also important, even if we are not planning to be physically absent any soon, but it's important from the very beginning, once the employees, we have a team that has been with us for some time already, and they already learn about the culture of the organization, they learn about this shared leadership and responsibility, it's important to start delegating small things while you are still present. So this is something that it will create the sensation that delegating is a common thing in the company. It's not just something that is a response to a situation. Okay, I have to leave and I need someone to take my place. No, delegating is part of the organization. So we need to start delegating tasks little by little. Maybe we can start by very basic tasks, and this is what we did. Okay, so from now on, we talked to one employee, can you help me sending this kind of emails or passing this kind of orders or calling the customers to reconfirm the bookings? Maybe the language barrier was a problem as my restaurant was in Thailand and most of the customers were English speaking. So maybe this was something that we had to do again, little by little, calling, contacting the customers, etc. So these are small tasks that we started delegating, and we started also observing how comfortable the employees were with this delegation and with this task. We looked at their ability, we looked at their level of confidence, we looked at how they executed their tasks, but also very importantly, we look at how they interact with each other when they are taking these responsibilities. Even if you are still there in the background, it's important to see how other employees see and perceive these tasks being implemented or being taken by other employees. Is there some jealousy? Is there some mistrust, etc.? So this is something that we need to observe as well. The last thing in this part of pre-absence, I would say that it's very important as well. It would be giving praise and giving credit, both privately and publicly. When we do it privately, it's a way of motivating the employees who are being delegated the tasks. So it means that they will be knowing that if they are doing a good job or they could improve, there's some room for improvement, but also they will get more motivation because they get some feedback. The second one, it would be about crediting, about saying this person now is in charge of this or have been in charge of this for the last week, and we are very happy with the performance. And you say to everyone, this is, again, one way for preparing the other employees. They will get to know that once the leader is not there physically or for other reasons, there will be a person who can do this already. So they will feel less abandoned. And the second one is another way of motivating. Oh, this employee is taking some jobs apart from the normal operation, and then he's getting some praise. I want that for me as well. So this is a way of motivating and getting them prepared. Then the second stage, that would be the actual preparing for the actual absence. Okay, we have created this culture, but now I know that I'm going to be away for some time. Physically, I'm not going to be here. What do I need to do? Number one would be the first step. It would be making clear the authority, giving authority, but not just giving the authority to the persons you are giving the authority, but making sure that everyone understands who has the authority when the leader is not there. Also, we need to prepare everything with time, enough coordination, etc. So this is something that we need to plan ahead. Whenever you know that the leader is going to be absent physically for some reasons, so we need to give enough time to get everything ready. In terms of feedback that I mentioned before, feedback needs to be there, but always from a constructive point of view. Even if there's something that hasn't been made as planned, there's always the constructive feedback, of course. We focus first on the positives and then how to improve. And the last point that I should mention is about when you are trying to set this kind of structure, it's very important to set it also in the compensation side. Of course, these people who are taking the leadership in your place when you are not physically there, they need to be economically compensated, but not just economically compensated, in a way of also giving some recognition. As we know, some employees, they are better motivated by recognition rather than by money. So this is something we should have in mind. I think that overall, this structure it can be useful both from the physical size of the absent, but also if something happens and there's another type of absent leadership that could be accidental or could be planned, etc., the team will be ready for whatever situation happens. So this is my experience and how we could prevent these negative consequences of absent leaders.
Great. Thank you very much, George. This is very insightful, and it helps us to see how, in practice, leaders can prevent emergence of absent leadership, notably in the team where we have shared leadership, in case if we have primary and secondary leadership roles that have to be complementary and help the whole organization to reach its common organizational goal. So we have learned that there is another very important takeaway to remember. Well, first of all, it's important to remember that prevention of absent leadership is more efficient and more cost-effective in practice rather than managing the consequences of absent leadership that has been happening. Finally, there is another takeaway that we should keep in mind. So our takeaway number five is that organizational and employee development practices, such as those mentioned by George, could help preventing absent leadership. So such employee development practices and organizational development practices include the implementation of situational leadership principles continuously, the use of appropriate organizational design, instilling the culture of shared and dynamic leadership where the roles of a leader could be given on permanent or temporary basis, taken away, but rewarded appropriately. And finally, it's important to remember that sustainable human resource management oriented at maintaining performance in long-term perspective could be a great way forward. That's the logic through which we implement situational leadership and where we delegate and build the teams over time to make sure that our leadership system is efficient. So that was very interesting and insightful. And now I would like us to think all together as experts about practical recommendations that we can give to individual employees and to managers as well as organizations regarding ways to move forward by preventing absent leadership, managing eventual consequences, and all of that with a purpose to support the workplace well-being. So I would like to ask our experts, first of all, what would you recommend to individual employees that are dealing with absent leadership and their lower performance? And number two, what would you recommend to managers regarding the ways how organizations could address absent leadership and the resulting poor talent management? So maybe Alessandro would like to start.
Thank you. Yes. Addressing the two focus. Starting with the manager, I would finally recommend different factors to be more specifically and practical. One factor is indeed acquiring academic knowledge, theoretical knowledge, as we are teaching the universities, because it's not only specific skills the manager can learn in economy class, but also leadership skills that cannot be taken for granted, okay? Academic skills refer to learning how to manage people in terms of leadership styles, situational leadership. The second ingredient, I would emphasize the need to train emotional intelligence, because this is a sensitivity, is a capacity, because be theoretically informed is necessary, but maybe not enough, because we need also to develop our attitude to be self-reflexive and self-aware about how we listen, how we respond to the other person, to the other request, even when the employee's request or way to talk, it can be very demanding. Some employees are showing contradictory behaviors. Some people are afraid to talk. Some people are more suspicious. Some people are, you know, more willing to participate. Other people are instead more willing to do the job by themselves. So sensitivity, our capacity to listen properly, is a skill that needs to be trained on the field, on the job. Another third ingredient, more practical, I would keep in mind what we say the four motivational drives, what the leader can practically do, not only to fulfill money and benefit and reward and compensation, that is very important, but also creating a clear communication to the team about the company culture, the company mission, the company values, to create the brand, to create the proudness. We are together achieving this value, this goal, this passion. What makes us as a team be different than the competitors? In this way, you help your people to move away from internal conflict to a good, sane competition with the competitors. Otherwise, we are absent, you know. So, also, going on the line to what also George mentioned in his practical cases in his company, I would remember the importance for the other drives, comprehend, to try to understand what is my role as an employee. Okay, why is important? So job design is a practical tool that we can enhance. Job design is starting, first of all, in the recruiting process to carefully select the people, not only based on their experience, academic background and skills, but also based on their personalities. Because some personality that are congruent to the position correlate to a more higher engagement, because there is no doubt that people are good in doing a job, but the engagement is higher when there is a congruence. So carefully hiring people according to this congruence is a practical tool to ensure presence leadership. Second angle, when the people are there, establishing a mutual dialogue with formal and informal meeting to ensure the people are prevented when they have problems. When, you know, when they have a problem, they keep silent, and then we said before, they enter in sabotaging behavior. So dialogue, open door policy, proactive listening, these are practical guidelines to ensure that leader. I clarify, I'm only referring to the general president. Leader can be the senior one. It can be the team leader. So it's a very structured orientation to leadership to ensure that all the people can report and be supported. Né? So these are some practical suggestions. There are many more, but this can be some takeaways that we can focus. Perhaps right. My colleagues can add more.
Oh, if our colleagues would like to build on Alexandra's suggestions, that also could be a great idea. So what are our other experts willing to say about that?
Thank you very much, Alessandra. I mean, I think one of the things that we should not overlook is that we do expect a great deal from our leaders, especially now looking at COVID and everything else. The demands and expectations we place on leaders has grown exponentially. Once upon a time, it was very much about performance focus. Now suddenly we expect these people to be psychologists and counselors and various other aspects, some of which they've not ever really had to imbue, nor have they been supported in gaining. So in that sense, as leaders, especially in the past 2 years, one can imagine how that those struggles could also have affected their well-being and their own health. And particularly if you look at a lot of the emphasis that organizations place, they place it on employees, they place it on supporting if you like, talent, etc., as opposed to really accounting for and addressing the well-being of the leaders. And obviously, if the leaders are not receiving the support and care that they need, then obviously it does follow that they will withdraw, they will hold back as they begin to struggle more and more. So an important consideration, I think, from a wellness perspective, well-being perspective, is for organizations to really ensure that leaders don't just become instruments that they use, but that they do really account for and care for their well-being. The other thing that I think, and this follows very much on from Alessandro, is to recognize that leadership is not a function in the same fashion a manager is. So in this sense, for example, informal leadership can often play a critical role in many teams. They're no different, therefore, that, and in absence of informal leaderships, somebody who the team turns to for confidence or advice or expertise is also a concern to consider. So absent leadership is also about ensuring that informal leaders are given support and the recognition they need, even without the formal title, to play a crucial role in bringing together the teams in their social roles, in their social capital.
Yeah, so that's a very interesting insight. Indeed, we need to remember that managers and leaders also represent a social group within an organization with its own hierarchy, and giving recognition for both formal and informal leadership roles, whether they are primary or secondary leadership roles, is one of the ways to move forward. It's also one of the ways to build the recognition for leadership, which prevents the absent leadership emergence. And it goes in line with the principles of sustainable human resource management, allowing people to develop within an organization and grow over time.
Thank you.
Great. So, George, would you like to build upon that?
Sure. Well, thank you very much for interesting insights from both of you. From the question about how managers should address this, I think most of the example I gave you was from the perspective of management as well. But just summarizing, it would be mainly creating a culture. I like what you mentioned about sustainable human resources. So it's something that we should be more proactive than reactive. So we should know that this exists. There can be absent leadership, even if it's something that is physical or other type of absent leadership, and it can happen in our organization. So how can we get ready, or how can we prevent the negative consequences? So yeah, mainly creating a culture, as I was mentioning in my example, making sure that everyone knows the direction of the organization, fostering the organizational citizenship behavior so that employees, they believe that they are part of the organization, and it will be a synergy between the organization and them. It would be positive, not just doing whatever they need to do to get their salary at the end, that this was one of the negative consequences that we saw, but also being motivated to be in the organization. From the perspective of the employees, Alessandro mentioned that it's very important about the roles of the employees. I think that apart from the employees knowing very well their roles, they should also know that what can they do aside from their role if they want their organization or themselves to be successful. This is something very important because they should, not just from the perspective of the leadership, but from the side of employees, they should try to equate the company success with the personal success. So they should know that if the company is successful, it's very likely that they're going to be successful, or they're going to keep improving as well. And another perspective is the importance of teamwork, again, from the perspective of the employees. If there are some negative situations, or there's some absent leadership, or there are some moments in which they believe that there's no clear direction for their job, they need to try to work as teams, because they, one of the functions of teamwork, it would be giving leadership as well in situations in which there's not a present leader over there. So if I was an employee and these negative situations are happening, or I'm absent of a leader, etc., I should ask myself, what can I do, or what could I do for the success of the company, which is not limited to my own role, but which is will be a positive encouragement for my own success as well.
Great. Thank you very much, George. And this highlights the importance of formulating and communicating common organizational goals, to which both employees and leaders in the organization could adhere, as well as managers in broader sense of this term as representatives of the ownership of the company. So that's very insightful, and this set of practical advices closes our today's session. So today we have learned together with our experts, first of all, what absent leadership is, what does it mean? We learned that it results ultimately in poor group dynamics and creates obstacles from achieving personally and collectively significant long-term goals. As a result, absent leadership can trigger even higher stress and undermine well-being of all people involved in an organization as a social group. We have also learned that absent leadership is particularly threatening for talent management, because it leads to suboptimal performance across all the organizational levels. Finally, we went through a range of solutions that companies can do, and we have seen that preventing absent leadership is a much more efficient tool for addressing common workplace well-being rather than treating the consequences. We have seen that putting in place organizational and employee development actions can really help to prevent absent leadership. So these actions could take form regular and long-term implementation of situational leadership approach and emotional intelligence, implementing appropriate organizational designs that helps people to see and meet common organizational goals is also very helpful. And finally, we have seen that crafting a sustainable human resource management system can be particularly valuable for preventing absent leadership. In case if we do have to face with absent leadership in our organization, we can focus on achieving commonly valuable goals for the whole organization and turn to our teams to express our concerns in a constructive way and address common goals in our company together with our leaders and the management team. So I would like to thank all of our experts that have been here with us today. Thank you for your presentation and for sharing your insights. And I wish to our audience successful implementation of these recommendations and practice for leading for their well-being. Thank you very much and goodbye.